I have been looking for an opportunity to tell you about our recent mission trip to Nicaragua. Don't think this is the only time I'm ever going to mention it. But today is a good day to talk about it, and I want to share with you a little bit about our experiences there. Most of you know that about a month ago, about 20 of us from Columbus area went to Nicaragua on a mission trip. Most of those 20 folks were our own parishioners, but three or four were not. They're just associated with us, and they went with our group. It was a wonderful, wonderful experience. We went back to a place that I have been to now three times. Some of the folks in our group have been there twice, and some all three times that I've been to the same place. We went to a little fishing village that's on the northwest coast of Nicaragua. We flew into Managua, which is the capital of Nicaragua, and then we took a bus at least 3 hours north of the capital to finally reach this little fishing village. It's an absolutely beautiful place right there on the side of the ocean with natural beauty that just doesn't really compare. It's really wonderful. We went to this place to be with the people in this little village. We went back to the same place where we'd already established some relationships, and so that was wonderful for us. You know that some people go to places like Nicaragua to on mission trips to build things. They build houses or schools or other kind of helpful things that they can do, projects working on water supply. There's numerous kinds of building projects going on. Mission trips are very common in Nicaragua. Lots of people take groups there. Our trip was not designed to build something. We went really to a small place to build relationships, to help make connections with a real defined group of people. We were able to help them in some ways materially. Just going there, just taking a group there, is a boost to their economy because we employ people that help take care of us while we're there. And we provide some relief to the people living in the village too, some food and other things like that, based on the money that we've raised. To kind of give you a better idea of kind of what we do while we're there, if you can kind of imagine what takes place here in a vacation Bible school. We did similar things there. Children from all over the village come and are accustomed to groups being there, and they come every day just to be with us, to be in relationship with us, to play. We have organized games and art activities, and we talk to them about our faith, and we worship together, and we tell them about Jesus, and we do some interesting things with them. But mostly just to love them, share meals with them, be with them. The place where we stayed is very simple. It's an open-air pavilion. There are no walls to it, really. Just a thatched roof, big open area. And this place where we stay, they call it the Rancho. But really, it's the community center for this little village. It's really the only gathering place in this little village. The people come together for all sorts of reasons, but particularly when they're visiting groups like ours. Come together at this little place called the Rancho. I need to say something about the children there. The children are absolutely beautiful. I can't really explain to you how beautiful the children are that live in this little village and that come to us. They are so happy to see us, and we are so happy to see them. They're wearing their best clothes, and they're all scrubbed clean, and their grins from ear to ear, and they're just so excited. It's wonderful. If you just can have the opportunity to pop down right where we were in this little rancho, in this little community center, and see these beautiful, joyful children, and seeing us interact with them, you'd think it was the most charming picture you'd ever seen. It's just picture perfect. The love and the joy, these beautiful children having a But if you walk past the gates of where we were staying in this little community center, this little rancho, you'd see a different picture. This is my third time of going. I can remember the first year that I went to Nicaragua on a mission trip like this. And I walked outside the gates where we were staying, and I really paid attention to how people were living there. I was so completely shocked. The poverty of the people there is so hard to take in, so hard to pay attention to, so hard to describe to you. We have plenty of poor people around us in Columbus, Georgia, that's for sure. But the poverty here doesn't compare to the poverty there. The people who live in that little fishing village live in such simple ways like you can hardly even imagine. They live in little dwellings that we would consider shacks, made a lot of times out of found materials. Their homes are something about the size of your bathrooms at home. That's their entire home. And it's cobbled together pieces of wood or metal or whatever. Those who have resources sometimes have a little cinder block building. And those often don't even have doors and windows in them. They don't have running water at their homes. They often have dirt floors. They don't have plumbing of any kind. They have to walk to get water, and there are no bathrooms for them to use in their homes. Out of these environments come these beautifully, wonderfully kept children that come to us at this community center. The first year I was there, I was so shocked by the poverty. I was so shocked by what I saw, by the way they live. I wanted to do all that I could to change their environment. My mind was racing that first year. How can I do something? How can I get an organized crew to come back next year and build some nicer housing for them? How can we get the government here to do something to improve the quality of their lives? How can we get running water to their homes? How can we improve the schools? How can we get more resources for them? How can we find more jobs for them? The only jobs that are available usually for the men, they are fishing. They go out at night and come back in the morning on simple little boats, and the boats are full of fish, much like we hear about in the Bible. Some of them are kind of property guards. The jobs really are non-existent there. How can I change them? That was in my head and my heart the first year. The second year I went back to the same place to be with the same people. It was wonderful. I'd already established relationships with them. I was so thrilled to see them, and they were thrilled to see me. And I felt that I was spending less time, less emotional energy, less thoughts about how to improve their lives, and I was paying more attention to the people in front of me, to these wonderful children. I felt like I was able to engage more with the children, have more real conversations with them, even though the language barrier was challenging. I was able to be more in the moment with those children and those adults in that place. And it was a blessing to be back. The third year, this year, when I was there, something was even more different for me about my experience. This time, I didn't spend all of my time and energy trying to figure out ways to improve their lives. This year, I tried to really pay attention to them, to the people that were there, and how I was feeling about those people in that moment. And you know what happened to me this year in my experience in Nicaragua? I had a realization. I realized at some point in this trip that there are things that those children and those adults have that we don't. And there are some ways that their lives are better than the quality of our lives. Yes, they have simple lives. Yes, they have worries and concerns. They don't have any money. Of course they worry about how they're going to feed their families. Of course they worry about how they're going to clothe their families. But they have riches that we sometimes don't have, or we neglect or fail to see in our own lives. The quality of their lives is good. Though Those people that live in that fishing village know every single person that lives within miles of where they live. They know all of them, and they know them well. And they walk past their houses every day, and they take care of each other, and they know their neighbor, and they love their neighbor, and they take care of their neighbor. They don't wear watches. They're not attached to their smartphones 9 hours out of the day. They talk to each other. They engage one another. And you know what? They are so full of the joy of the Lord that it is unbelievable. Yes, they have challenges, and their faith brings them through their challenges every day, and they are living testimony of what God can do and does. We go there to take Jesus to them, and we wind up getting more Jesus from them than we provide them in our activities that we do for the children. Those of you who've been on mission trips before know that this happens. When you go on a mission trip, you get back more than you give. And I had this realization that the reason for my trip, perhaps, was for me to have a change of heart about the way I live my life, about my faith, about my blessings, about the things that I worry about, the pity, the trivial little things in my life that I worry about, to try to lay them aside, to give thanks to God for what I saw and what I experienced there, and what a gift. Shift now and focus just a minute to the gospel reading we heard today. Jesus fires out 5 little parables for us, and we've heard them before, and then these pithy little stories, pithy little statements that Jesus tells his disciples, and they're a bit confusing, and we're supposed to get something out of them, but it's a challenge sometimes. The gospel writer Matthew has Jesus saying these words, "The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in the field. The kingdom of heaven is like a pearl of great value or a net thrown into the sea." But scholars will tell us that Jesus is not talking about the great hereafter. Jesus is telling these parables to his listeners. He's talking about right now. The kingdom of God is what he's talking about. This kingdom of God that is breaking into the world right now. This kingdom of God that is breaking into the lives of individual believers right now. It's hard to understand how God is working in our lives and how God is working. And so we have these little stories about this tiny little mustard seed that you can't even hardly see grows into something enormous that shelters the birds. This tiny little piece of leaven that you can hardly even see mixed with flour makes this enormous piece of bread that feeds a large family. This treasure hidden in a field that nobody can see. This man knows about it, and it so consumes his life that he can't stand it anymore, and he has to have that treasure. The same with the pearl. And then God gathers us all in a net at the end in this gospel parable. What on earth can we take from these gospel parables? I've read lots of commentaries about them. I've read lots of explanations about them. It's hard to make sense of all 5 of them together because they seem so different. And I'll give you my quick spin on what I think Jesus wants you and me in this current day and age to understand from these gospel parables. I think Jesus wants us to know that the kingdom of God is growing always. The kingdom of God is taking root always. In our lives, in communities like Trinity Church, Columbus, Georgia, and in the world. And we often don't notice it. We are often preoccupied with our own lives and our preconceived notions of how the world ought to be, that we fail to see God at work in our lives and in our communities and in the world, just like I failed to see what was really going on in Nicaragua in my first year there. So the kingdom of God grows. I think Jesus also wants us in this parable to understand that God often surprises us. The little things sometimes are enormous. And the things that we sometimes think are enormous are really small things. And God is at work in our lives and in our communities and in the world. And our anxiety about it all sometimes clouds what's really going on with God. I tried to think of some example of some other way in which I have experienced a kingdom parable kind of situation in my own life. And I realized that I've had one since I came back from Nicaragua. And I'll tell you this little story and I'll try to make this fast. The danger of me preaching without notes is that I'm going to go on for a long time. But I'll try to make this brief. You know that we have a downtown church. And you know that every day that our doors are open, someone walks through the doors of this church and asks us for some assistance of some kind. We are surrounded by people in need, and we're a downtown church, and people that have real needs come through our doors every single day. And we talk to them, and we try to help them get the help that they need from agencies and the city, and sometimes we're able to help them ourselves. We have a discretionary fund. You give generous donations to our discretionary funds that help us be able to help really people in serious need with all kinds of things. Well, a couple of weeks ago, we had a woman, and I'll call her Nellie. That's not her real name, but I'll call her Nellie. Nellie came to the door, and Nellie is a regular, if you know what I mean. Nellie comes here a lot, off and on. I haven't seen her for a while before now, but I know her well, because for 5 years I've been here, I've had lots of conversations with her, and we've helped her on numerous times. So Nellie came back, and when I saw her walk through the door, I immediately thought, oh no, here she comes again. But I listened to her, and we were able to help her get some things that she needed, some food or some other things. And then after a long while, because she really liked to talk, she left and went away. 2 days later, she came back. And guess what? She had other things that she needed help with. And it's hard for us to know who to help and when to help, because you don't know what people's real needs are. And we have a limited amount of resources, too. So this time when she came back, we sent her away. We told her we could not help her. And that was difficult to do. That didn't feel good for any of the staff here to be able to send her away. The next day, I was in the grocery store. And I walked into the grocery store, and I walked into the produce section, and guess who I bumped into? Nellie. And she said, Pastor, I need to talk to you. And I was trapped between the tomatoes and the carrots. And I could not move in the grocery store for a long time while she told me all the things going on in her lives and all the things that I just heard a couple of days before that she needed in her life. Something was different. I was in a different context. I was in a different place. I saw her differently. I heard her differently. God used that chance coincidence of being in the same place to do something in me. And I made her some promises that I would help her. And she came back to the church the next day, and we were able to help her get resettled into a new apartment in a significant way. And you know what? it felt really good to do that. Now, if I compare that to the kingdom parables, I would say that there was a seed in me that was planted long ago with this person. And I don't know how, but God all of a sudden made that seed grow into something really big. And I was able to see this person more like God sees this person. And it was right, and it was good, and it was a blessing to both of us. I think that's what we're to take from these gospel readings, is that God is active and alive in your life and in this community and in the world. And sometimes it's just a seed. And sometimes God surprises us. And that seed takes hold of our lives. And we become more like the other parable, where the pearl is everything. The field is everything. And Jesus wants us to see this world like it's God's world. And give everything to that understanding. The world is God's, and God is moving in the world, and God is using us. Maybe we are the mustard seed that lie dormant for a long time, and then God takes hold of us, and we become a tree, and others can find shelter there. And it's God who has done the work. Parables sometimes we need to hear over and over and over again. I hope you'll read these parables again. I hope you'll think about how God is active in your life. Be ready to be surprised by what God can do in your life. And be ready to be